I was married to Linda for 28 years, and we immigrated to Canada in 1976 from England. We had three daughters in 4 years, and that's when the story really starts.
I believe that our community knows what good palliative care looks like and feels like because of Linda's legacy, because of the vision that she had, because of the work of countless professionals and volunteers in the early days that continues on today.
She loved life. She was so full of joy and fun, and she almost vibrated. She would skip. She would actually skip. And when she was walking down the hall,
she had a lot of opposition, so it was an uphill battle for her to accomplish what she did accomplish. And her legacy of over 20 years of building, you know, the foundation of what we have here now is just superb. It's just superb.
Well, Linda, I think one of her enduring legacies to us now is the clear vision that she had early on, and it sustained us, I think, in this work. And that is bringing the expertise to the dying person and to their family. And she really encouraged looking at the dying person as a whole person, not just someone who needed medical attention, but, you know, their social and their spiritual and emotional needs as well.
Hello.
Hi, Mary. It's Evelyn and John here.
Okay, come on up.
Linda's vision was to bring the expertise wherever that dying person was.
You know, palliative care, I think, hopefully happens everywhere. I mean, our job is to help people who have a possible life-threatening illness be more comfortable. Our real goal is to give people what they want. And studies have shown that a majority of people want to die at home.
Individuals who are at their end of life really want to, for the most part, stay within their home environment. You need to meet the person where they're at, and you need to provide the comforts to allow this to happen.
Dr. Bowering started with the Sisters of St. Joseph's and just a very tiny committee of individuals, started palliative care here at the hospital. So the difference really in palliative care at the hospital is we handle patients. We do a lot of pain and symptom managements for patients who are in the acute care phase of their illness. They may have had chemotherapy and have developed a fever or some kind of an infection and can't be managed at home, or their symptoms are so severe that they need to be, their pain medication may need to be switched to something different, or their nausea is quite bad and needs to be controlled. And generally speaking, we can do those things quicker in hospital with the plan of sending the patient either back home or to hospice, wherever their, whatever their wish is or whatever their goals are.
Good. I'm very fortunate.
Okay, see you later.
Okay.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Linda really discovered the power of music therapy and how important it was.
I think music therapy has such a tremendous impact on the healing and the emotional well-being of patients, but also for the whole circle of family that comes together at palliative care and other areas throughout the hospital.
Nice to meet you.
From my personal experience, there are songs that you hear and it brings back a memory so vividly. And for some patients, not only in palliative, but for their families, that vivid memory really helps and comforts in a difficult time. It can bring tears and sadness, but it can also bring comfort. And I know that Linda's memory has really allowed that to happen with so many families and patients here. And the endowment was such a wonderful gift because it's a legacy in her memory that keeps on giving year after year. People are seeing the difference that music therapy is making on the lives of the patients and their families every time they're here at Blue Water Health.
Well, some people ask, how is it that we in Sarnia Lambton can have such robust services, such a seamless approach to hospice palliative care? And it really has to do with how committed our community has been since the 80s.
We are so fortunate here at hospice with the team of volunteers that we have. We really wouldn't be able to offer the support and the programming that we do have without our volunteers.
It is just amazing at how supportive. You know, we raise money in this community, $6 million to build that hospice.
I think for most people they're very surprised at the amount of programming that we do offer, because I think most people think that hospice is encompasses just the residential hospice. We support the family right from the moment of diagnosis with all the various programs that we offer. We provide services for the children who have a loved one who has been diagnosed with a terminal illness. So we provide illness support to the children. We're our coordinator. We'll work with the kids and help them create memories, as well as through art and play activities. And then we also provide bereavement support for the children as well. To them, it's just play, you know, and telling their stories. But it's really helpful and healing for the children to be able to tell their story and to normalize their feelings and what they're going through.
Sometimes for people who don't have the family supports or who have a lot of symptoms, they either come to the hospital, but more often they come here, which is a home away from home here at St. Joseph's Hospice. And we are so lucky to have this.
People just don't realize how much care you get here. When you die with dignity in this place. You really do. And that's what I really love about this place. And that's why when it is time for me, this is where I'll be.
It's an incredibly rewarding job. People ask me all the time, how can you do that? I mean, that seems like a horrible job. It is so rewarding to have a patient come in who is suffering, whether it's pain or it's nausea or just existential suffering, because they're worried, they have a huge fear of the end, and I can tell them, we can take care of you.
My name is Eddie Schramick, and I have inoperable prostate cancer that's gone into my bladder and into the lymph nodes. It's absolutely beautiful here. We need more hospice. We don't have enough hospice No, it's really nice here. It's more than I ever thought. I didn't expect to be this comfortable dying, you know? Here, oh, there's so much relief, there's so much happiness. Things have just turned around 180 degrees for me, because I was afraid. I was so afraid to die alone. Not now. No way, Jose. It's good. You couldn't ask for a better place to be. No way. Oh, you are so good. I love that.
Linda had a great desire in her time of dying to remain at home. We put together a team, and it became known as Linda's Ladies. And so we basically walked the journey with Linda, those of us privileged to attend her at her final days.
Ironically, even though Linda was involved in palliative care for 20 years, I didn't really understand what palliative care was until she herself became a patient. She was literally an inspiration to all those around her. She never complained. She obviously had sad thoughts, but she kept them to herself and really became a model patient. And then she died at home in her sleep. And we all mourned her passing, but celebrated her life and her inspiration and the legacy that she left, not only with palliative care, but in our family and in our extended circle of friends.